President Trump reiterated today that the U.S. must leave Afghanistan, saying American troops are not a police force. But the horrors of that war were again brought into sharp focus with yesterday's cruel strike on a maternity hospital. And now, as the U.S. is withdrawing, the fate of one American held hostage lies in the balance. Here's Amna Nawaz.
A solemn prayer for the lives brutally taken in yesterday's attack on a maternity ward in Kabul. Crews today hastily worked to dig fresh graves for the victims, including expectant mothers and newborns.
I saw 8 dead bodies of women in this ward, and 7 other dead bodies were in the other ward, on the beds, and they were hitting their heads or faces.
As authorities were responding to yesterday's assault in Kabul, scores more were killed in the eastern province of Nangarhar. There, a suicide bomber attacked a funeral for the local police commander. The Taliban denied involvement in either of yesterday's attacks, but Afghan President Ashraf Ghani ordered his military to ramp up.
I order all the Afghan security and defense forces to come out of defensive mode back to offensive and start their operations against the enemy.
Yesterday's violence is just the latest crack in the already fracturing U.S. deal with the Taliban. In late February, the two parties entered into an agreement led by President Trump's appointed negotiator, Ambassador Zalmay Khalilzad. The U.S. would begin a troop withdrawal to end America's longest war, and in exchange, the Taliban would stop attacks on U.S. forces and deny other militant groups safe haven. The Afghan government was not part of that initial agreement, but the deal set the ground for further direct negotiations between Afghanistan and the Taliban. Those negotiations have been stalled in part by disagreements over prisoner exchanges and continued Taliban attacks on Afghan security forces. And the chaos and calamity raise questions about the fate of American Mark Frerichs. The 57-year-old U.S. Navy veteran was working as a commercial contractor in Afghanistan when he was kidnapped at the end of January. U.S. officials believe he is held by the Haqqani Network, a faction of the Taliban. Earlier, I spoke with Frerichs' family from their home in Lombard, Illinois. His sister, Charlene Sikora, is a retired gas company supervisor. Her husband, Chris, is a truck driver working overnight shifts. It's the family's first interview, exclusive to the NewsHour.
So a lot of people will hear his story, and they're going to wonder, what was he doing in Afghanistan?
He's been there over 10 years, and he was doing construction work. He just enjoyed it and stayed out there. And
found he could make very good money, tax-free money. And they let him do the kind of work that he liked to do that he really couldn't find here. So he enjoyed the environment and kept going back and eventually stayed. So we were kind of amazed at it, but it's something that he wanted to do. So we supported him.
Tell us how you came to know that he had been kidnapped.
We found out Sunday morning, Groundhog Day. We had a knock on our door at 9 o'clock in the morning, and it was Lombard police and the FBI came to our door and basically told us they wanted to talk to us, and they explained to us that my brother Mark has been kidnapped by the Taliban and the Haqqani group.
And what did you think in that moment?
I was shocked. I thought it was that I didn't believe it. I just basically couldn't say over again, are you sure, are you sure? And they were very sure. I really didn't come into reality on it until then. They came to my house the following Tuesday, and I talked to Washington, D.C., and the whole big group, and then the reality set. And I just still can't believe it. And I cry every now and then at night, and I just think about what he's going through right now. Is he being bathed? Is he being fed? Is he clothed? I mean, is he warm? Does he have a pillow? I mean, I just can't imagine what he's going through right now.
Have you been able to get any kind of update on his well-being?
They're letting us know, the FBI, and when we talked to Zal, they basically are saying that he is alive. They're not saying that he's well, because they don't know. I mean, but they are saying that they don't have any reason to think that he's dead. But so they feel that he is still out there.
And when you say Zal, I should clarify, you mean Ambassador Zalmay Khalilzad, who's the chief U.S. negotiator dealing directly with the Taliban. But just last week, the FBI released a poster seeking information about the release of your brother. There was even a reported U.S. Special Forces raid looking for information on him and his whereabouts. Do you believe, Charlene, that the U.S. is doing everything that they can to get Mark released?
Sometimes I think yes, and sometimes I think no. I know this COVID thing has taken over, and I feel that the FBI and the U.S. government's doing what they can do, but I really don't feel comfortable that Zal is doing anything, and he's the one that's got the power to do all, you know, to get Mark home safely.
It sounds like Zal is still more worried about doing a prisoner exchange of great numbers rather than looking at the importance of one person, and that's Mark, and getting Mark home.
Let me ask you about what it is you'd like to see, because now you have the U.S. chief negotiator who's dealing with the Taliban saying, I have asked them to do everything they can. Clearly, he's working under the direction of President Trump. So what else specifically do you want to see the U.S. government do to make sure that Mark is released?
That no negotiations go on about trading prisoners or anything in that regards until Mark is brought home. Then, you know, whatever they need to do, they need to do, but they need to put Mark first.
You'd like to see the entire negotiation process stop until there's a precondition that Mark is released. Is that right?
I believe that would be right, yeah.
And if the process moves forward without that precondition, what are you worried would happen?
That he'd be forgotten. That, you know, we all need to understand, too, that Zal's professional and an ambassador, and that's what he's going to do with or without certain accomplishments. But our concern is only for Mark.
Let me make this clear, though, because we are talking about America's longest war, right? Three presidents have tried to end this now, and President Trump believes that we could be closer than ever to having some kind of a deal and getting U.S. troops home. Are you worried that the commitment to that goal could mean that Mark gets left behind?
Very much so.
Yes.
Very much so.
I have a very fear I think of every day that I'm going to wake up some morning and this is all going to be signed and clear and Mark's not home safely. And the peace deal has been signed and done, a done deal with, and Mark still is out there. And what are we going to do then?
We've seen President Trump get very directly involved to try to negotiate prisoners' release in the past from different countries. Do you think it would help Mark's case if he were to do the same in this situation?
I think it would do more help than harm at this point. And he's shown he's a pretty powerful guy. He's gone up toe-to-toe against the strongest leaders in the world and come out okay.
Yeah, I really support Donald, the President Trump, that he will bring my brother home safely. He's done it in the past with other prisoners. So I believe he'll get my brother home.
If you could deliver a message right now to President Trump, what would you say to him?
I would say, please bring my brother Mark home safely. And please don't do any more signing, any more deals until my brother is included in that deal and getting my brother home safe.
Charlene, let me ask you, because this is the very first interview anyone in your family has given, why are you talking to us today?
It's been long enough that I feel that we have to be a little stronger and move more forward and more aggressive. I have to get more out there, more to get the word out and maybe get President Trump a little bit more mentioning my brother Mark's name.
More motivated.
And more motivated. And I think the more my brother Mark's name is put out there, I think the more, you know, the power up there will do what they got to do because we are very concerned.
If you had a way of getting a message straight to Mark, what would you want to say to him right now?
I just want to tell him that we're doing everything we can to get you home. I miss you. And I just want you home safely. And I've worried about you over a decade with this. Mm-hmm. And we felt so comfortable that you were doing okay and you were safe out there. I guess we just let our guard down. But I want you home safe. And I'm doing everything I can to get you home safe. So just hang in there. He's my brother. I love him. My only brother. And we're only 2 years apart, so we were always close as kids and hung out. And he was always my bodyguard in high school when I got picked on. And has always been there for me. So I got to be here for him.
Charlene and Chris Sikora talking to us today from Lombard, Illinois. Thank you so much for your time. We wish you and your family all the very best.
Thank you for your time.